Okay, so how is judgment relinquished? So so this is really getting to the crux of it. We're getting away from theory and into very practical. You know, it's basically saying you can't, it's not that you're giving up judgment, you were never able to judge in the first place. We don't know enough. We don't know all the cause and effects of something we might do. We can't, this head is so limited for what it can know that it's basically saying you're deceiving yourself if you thought you were judging anything. And so, it's saying, but the good news is you have an alternative that knows everything. How cool is that? Okay, and so that's all, we're back to the same old paradigm again, giving up on ego, choosing Holy Spirit, and having a much easier time. Okay, that's kind of what this is getting at, very visceral way. Realizing we can't judge because we don't know anything. And it's interesting, this thing, remember what I was saying before, allowing judgment to come through us. You see, the ego wants to hijack this ever so subtly and have it be that somehow we're spiritually trained, you can decide these things and what you're doing. No. It's saying, no, all the wisdom that's coming from Holy Spirit, the experience you should have, is it's coming through you. It's not somehow making your ego better, and somehow your ego is then going out and being a servant of God. This is not this game. The ego is getting out of the way, and you're cleaning like the windshield, the mud off the windshield of a car, and the light is shining through it. So much easier. It just comes through you. And you know what? If it doesn't come through you, that's God's problem. Right? That's just that, you know, meaning you thought something should come through and it didn't. Well, that's it. That's just them, you know? I showed up. I was there. I was willing to talk and I didn't say or do something in a situation. That's because God didn't want me to do it. He didn't give me the words. And so, not my issue. I move on to the next thing. So it's this idea, this feeling that's coming through us. Not that we are somehow improving as practitioners. Now, that's a sense of it. There is a sense that we do get more skillful at an ego-based level. Of course we do. I mean, you know, so, but it's just giving us an idea that the responsibility lies with God. Again, we can relax. Why? Because he's the one doing the judging. We're off the hook, right? So isn't that cool? And see, judgment is a burden, judging. Thinking I have to know everything. You know, thinking I know what's right and wrong, whether the Tories should be in or Labor should be in, and Brexit, and on and on and on. I don't know anything. I don't know how anything ends up. And if I need to keep my eyes focused on God and allow the waking up process to happen, and not all these things become a burden in my mind. Or if I allow them to live in my mind and I feel burdened, it's like if you drink too much coffee, what happens? You get a bit hyper, don't you? Or if you don't get enough sleep, you feel tired. Is it the end of the world? No. But you know you did it to yourself. So if you want to watch the news and get caught up in it, no harm is going to come of it, but you are going to feel burdened and stressed. Don't worry about it. But, you know, at some point you get tired of it, and you can come back to the reality, which is we don't really know what's going on. And our guide is sure, he knows what's going on, okay? So, now, we may not, at an ego level, know what his big plan is, because it's very complicated and intricate, but he does, okay? And if he doesn't, by the way, if all this weren't true and there weren't inner guides, now you're left with the other side. It's pretty obvious his description of the ego is accurate. Ego is neurotic. It leads us to suffering, it doesn't know what's going on, da 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 da. We can kind of get that. If we don't have a Holy Spirit, an alternative, we're kind of screwed, aren't we? So this is a good bet. If I was betting, you know, and as you get experience, you get confidence in it. But even if your ego tries to say, well, what if this wasn't true? Well, you should think to yourself, well, is it better be true, or I'm really in trouble? Right? That can help sometimes. Whenever you doubt, is this really true? Help. Well, you know what? Forget it. I'm placing my bet on that being, you know, I'm placing my bet on that Jesus knew what he was talking about. Because if he didn't, I'm screwed anyway. So I bet I'm going to go down that way. That's another way of getting leverage on yourself in times of doubt. So, okay. Questions? Comments?
This is so not hard or difficult, but I think, like, part of me just feels if only I could comprehend the love of God, all of this would make me love. So that, maybe it's not impossible, but I just think that it sometimes feels like if I could just get my head around the fact that God loves me.
Can you just repeat this brilliant? If I can comprehend, you say. If I can get my head around it, you say.
Yeah.
Yes.
Just say, maybe even just experience the love of God. Because I know this text is here because God loves me. The truth, Christ came because I'm loved. Because love is the truth, opposed by no.
Yeah, your words give it away. you want your head to get this. I use the head as the ego. Not my head. Sorry.
So, that's what the whole innocence is for.
That is true, but I think even at a more simple level, your ego is saying, I want to get this. I want to understand what you use the word, I want to get my head around it, and I want to get the concept, I think you used it, you know, you want to get it intellectually. It's not comprehensible. I want to comprehend this, you said. Not going to happen.
I use a different word. It's just, the experience of God's love, I would like to be
as you
focus of.
Yeah, but you the experience of God's love is something you have an idea of what that is, don't you?
Yeah, definitely.
Right, that's the problem. Your ego has defined what it is, and you're not getting an experience that matches that, now you have grief. See how that works? Nice.
Yeah.
That's just all ego, spiritual ego spinning around and around in circles. What you need to do is say, I just want God who will reveal himself to me, and I'll accept that experience for whatever it is. I'll have no engineering, I will not have grievances about that I'm not getting. But your ego has created an experience here, and it wants to match that experience. It wants to understand, it wants its head around it. The quicker you give up on this ever getting that and being the vehicle, it's just the wrong vehicle. If you wanted to fly to the moon and you had to calculate your trajectory, would you try and use an iPhone? You know, it's got Google Maps, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
No, wrong piece of equipment.
Mm-hmm.
This is the wrong piece of equipment. Now, then I'll... That was good. So, can you do it again? Let's go airborne. No, but now let's back it up. So you wanted to do something. Right, you wanted to get your head around it, you wanted the concept, you want it all up here, and I'm saying it's the wrong piece of equipment. But wait a minute, there's something before that. There's a desire, right? So point at me where the desire to know comes from, pointing your body. I want. Right, exactly. See how that goes? I want like that. Eliminate that, and let's keep that. That's called a heart wish in Buddhism. The heart wish is their desire to wake up. This heart wish at its most pure desire is nothing but to know God again, to know ourselves, intensely desire. The ego knows that, and it tries to satisfy that desire through all kinds of things. Drugs, lust, whatever, intention does not want it getting really what it wants, because then the ego has no purpose, right? And so it's insulted. Remember the last reading? It's insulted. Of Course in Miracles says the ego feels insulted. So it's fighting against this. So your heart wish of wanting to know, hold on to that. That's power, because that power will motivate you to keep practicing, and that is, because there's, remember we talked about intention, so let's go there right now. Intention is a mechanical act. I intend to look at Dan. See how that works? I intend. There's something that comes before intention, desire. Desire is visceral. So the more we cultivate the desire for the kingdom of God, that's our power. That's the fuel that fuels the superpower. It's what directs it. So we want that. We want that heart wish. We want to be in touch with it. We just want the energy of it focused in the right direction. The ego will try and take that energy and distract it in a million things. Let me be rich. Let me have that certain woman. I can't get all that, so let me get drunk. Whatever. Anything to distract it from what it really wants. And so it's, hold on to that wish. Your heart wish is your energy. It's your homing beacon. But the training we get, the spiritual training, is to focus that. And the farther we go down the path, by the way, the narrower it gets and the more focused. So this idea we become lovey-dovey Christians and we're all going to be saved isn't really whatever we're seeing in all the traditions I've been in, Buddhism, Sufism, and even the most serious Christians. The path gets more narrow, more practice-oriented, more intense, more focused. Because we're getting more honed, the ego's being stripped out. But that's going to be more for later. But even the course, those lessons start off kind of airy-fairy, a couple minutes here and there, and by the end, it's getting you to really focus. It's the same thing. But the whole time we're doing it. Why are we doing it? The heart wish. I want to know how more than anything. And I'm unwilling to let things try and take the place of that. So the heart wish you have is good, but allow God to show you that. So pray to him and say, I want, but I'm not going to make any demands on what that looks like. Right? Because those are judgments. Does that make sense? So you're on the right track, but your ego is trying to answer. And it will never have the answer. Wrong piece of equipment, that's all. This piece of equipment has a use, but it's dangerous, by the way, this thing. But so is a buzzsaw, right? Buzzsaws have their use, a chainsaw. They're dangerous too, but correctly focused, they can cut the tree down or whatever. We need this. We need this to calculate. We need this to speak English. We need this. But the trick is we're refocusing and putting the heart in charge and letting this be the servant rather than an oppressor. Does that make sense? Remember, this does not get enlightened. This is simply a tool while we're alive. The heart is what's polished every time we practice. The heart is opened and our awareness of all of this increases as the Holy Spirit pours experiences into our heart. And we're slowly letting this go. Something like that. That helps.
I think just to add to it, I think for me, when I experience the love of God through asking for and receiving guidance. And as I have my practice for asking, and when it comes, especially when I'm having a difficult time, I have to go over to spirit. I have something will come and it develops trust, and it's usually everyone wins. It's one I don't feel the love. That's my experience.
Quickest shortcut for experiencing what we want is gratitude. So gratitude is usually a 12-step program. You're doing gratitude every night. It's massive. Gratitude and love are two sides of the same coin. And remember that experience of the enlightened mind is one of awe, and the second aspect is gratitude. Gratitude, you could say, isn't it amazing I even know to want to know the love of God? How cool is that? That chair doesn't have that ability. If a dog were running around here, it doesn't have that ability. You do. Isn't that amazing? Thank you for letting me at least know I want you. That's a start. Thank you. Isn't it amazing I have that? You see, we can just be in awe that we were even given the wherewithal to know that we want this. You see, to make God, what God made us into is fairly amazing. We can have this incredible, and you'll start, in that gratitude, you start to feel a really, really quick shortcut. Gratitude, be grateful for everything all day long. I'm a why, I'm this, I'm that, I'm in London. I know these are things I love to perform, but I even know to be aware of them in London. And mostly the gratitude I have these days, thank you for my mighty companions, thank you for the Course in Miracles, thank you for my practices that allow me to know you. Boy, that was a close one. Mm-hmm. Right? Because maybe I didn't do that once, right? Mm-hmm. You know, these things are, we take them for granted sitting in this room, these things are gifts, big time. If we lived in any other part of the world, we wouldn't be able to do this. You know, we might not have gotten into drugs and missed it. Mm-hmm. You know, so thank God we're sitting here, that's a miracle itself.
That's
awesome. Yeah, that is it. That will fuel you. And then I would very strongly suggest when you go home tonight, read the Happy Dream section and go watch my YouTube video. And we did a whole seminar on this, because then you're going to go, and when I want that with God, I get this happy dream thing. I'm signing up for that. That'll motivate you. It has a Happy Dream section in the book. It's called The Happy Dream. You can Google it. And we have a video. We did a whole workshop on the whole day on the Happy Dream section. Because then you go, yeah, God, those are the byproducts of doing this. I'm having that. You know, that's, I'm in it, you know, that helps.
Well, there's certainly a hijack there, Ken, because what you're saying is, oh yeah, I like happy life, but actually they are, what you have to do in order to get that happy dream is to just want the love of God that we were talking about, the love of God. You're not going to get it with your head, the very fact that you're fine with your head, that's what the focus is. You don't want that happy dream really, do you? But you get that.
It's in the book because it inspires us. It helps. He was having an issue with, I'm going to be crucified, so the happy dream is a bit of an antidote, I guess.
Well, yeah.
We are children. We're works in progress. These things help. It's in the book.
Right.
So, I can't say. So I didn't make it up.
You know, I can do the same thing and say, the love of God, I can feel like, I mean, I can play in same games where I think I'm manipulating God, I love you, but if you could give me the double garage with the car and the love you,
don't do
God,
that.
You know,
yeah.
Except, but you know what I mean, I could, I know that I can, even just sitting here listening to this, I can play that game where I am guilty of trying to coerce God into giving me my primary, whether it's my primary focus, which is, I suppose, my Achilles heel is the one for success and prestige and all that kind of stuff. But I know that that's just the game.
That's just ego.
That I can play. But for me, the love of your children is not separate from your love of God. It's a manifestation of that.
No,
in a sense.
It's complicated. For
yeah,
people.
No,
it's
okay.
Special.
Yeah.
What
yeah.
I experience, Mark, what you're talking about, the love of God, I have experienced fine, but I wasn't looking for it at the time.
Mm.
Once I was in an aquarium in front of the piranha tank, and once I was putting some bread away and broke it, and suddenly the whole instance just happened to the world fell away. And the second time it happened, I realised, so it felt the love of God, I realised the love I had for my children was conditional. I was on my love for my children was unconditional, but it's not, because it's conditional on them being my children. That's the condition. They had to be my children. But the love of God has no conditions attached. It goes and breaks it as much as it goes into the walls and lets it go into my children. And that is what, and I can't put it into words. My head never got to it, ever, ever, ever. But my point was, I wasn't actually going, oh God, show me what the love is. What is it? And then it came. My point is, my attachment to my children is exactly the same as my attachment to double garage.
Yeah.
Just because one is in I don't care much about it, but just because the kind of world falls, you know, being a good mom is more significant than having double garage. It doesn't actually make a difference at all, does it, Ken?
Well, all I hear is humility. You know, and serious practitioner, you're honest about your shit, your ego, and the shit you have. Everybody's got a different version of ego. We all have one, but they have a different version. All I hear is honesty and humility, brilliant. Great teaching lesson. We've all got versions of that, but it doesn't cause you a problem. You keep going. And by the way, so when you're not going to mess this up. So when your head's going blah blah blah, try to manipulate God, you're going to think, oh God, I've screwed it all. No, just ignore it. It's really hard to get your head around, but you can just. That part of the mind, just ignore it. It doesn't. It's not going to stop you. Just do your practices. Meditate and pray and do the Course in Miracles lessons, and then the whole thing carries itself. And what this thing is telling you, and the spiritual ego is relief. And just listen, ignore it. Go, yeah, whatever. And if you ever have a question, just open the book and say, Holy Spirit, what do you say about this? Just open the book and work. Read a paragraph. You'd be amazed. And you can just relax with it. And don't worry about this telling you this is some big, heavy thing that I'll work. It's actually very light, you know. So ego doesn't like that. It wants to be a serious, you know, thing, and I'm screwing up, and if I just manhandled it this way, it's that's the male energy. I struggled with that for a long time until I just gave up. I got broken. You get broken, and you just realize this isn't going to work, and I'm done and broken, and something happens, and he can come. It's amazing what God does when you decide you're broken. So that's why the step program works so well. I don't think what you said is any different whatsoever than what Kirsten just said. Just different versions.
Yeah.
Yeah. Different. You like, you know, if you were in a 12-step program, Kirsten likes white wine, you like scotch and soda.
Yeah.
You're both egoholics, you're both the same, that you're willing to be honest about it. And you give that to Holy Spirit, let him worry about it. That's his job. If you go to the happy dream section, one of my favorite statements in there is do not approach the Holy Spirit. Do not attempt to remove the fear and guilt from your mind before you approach Holy Spirit. That's his job.
Mm-hmm.
Do not. So I had this dentist once, and I tried, you know those dental things you get in the grocery store and you try and fix your teeth? He got so mad at me that I tried to fix his my own teeth. And he said, no, I'm the dentist. You come here when you have a problem to not fix your teeth. I never did it again.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a bit like that. Do not try and fix yourself. That's not our job, to fix yourself. That's Holy Spirit's job. Let him do his job.
Mm-hmm.
Our job is to go to the dentist and open our mouth so he can do his work and sit there and cooperate.
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of the analogy. So he let him take care of all those things. We all have versions of it. They're not harmful at all. And just give those. And we all have two or three major themes that we're working on that will take years and decades to work through. And accept that. That's part of your deal in this life. Holy Spirit's got it. You know, mine was powerful enough, you know, that I thought I needed to take care of it. You know, it was proximate to God. It was very, you know, scary. You know, so I had to work through it for decades. Even though when I knew what the game was. So knowing what the game was is self-knowledge. I have that sense. We're being radiated. We're like a Windows app. We're being, you know, the Windows radiates. You know, the very energy of my being is being radiated by the Word of God. And yet I have this part of my mind that's naive that it even exists. Isn't that funny? It thinks it's independent. Isn't that crazy? You know, we have these very complex bodies and this very complex situation. Mentally, spiritually, we're aware of some of that. And I actually think I just want to use it. There's no connection. That's crazy. But I have a sense that it's just that the molecules and the atoms and the quantum level are just energizing us. And I feel like this was all set up like a video game. And so that we had to consciously choose God. And to make it interesting, we had to have another choice. And that's what's going on. That's what it feels like. All the spiritual traditions, it just seems they all are like the setup. And we all have to. And of course, has its own explanation for that. It seems like. But whatever, the reason it came about is irrelevant. Here's where I find myself in now, with these two choices to make. I'm so good.
I'm just saying, following on from what I've been saying, I got involved with spiritual healing some years ago.
Spiritual
healing.
Healing.
Not necessarily very much spiritual healing.
Yeah.
And I found that when I got something there, you know, the aim was to get my ego out of the way and just be channeled.
Yeah.
And I found that it wouldn't matter who it was, and it could even be a paper. And I meant this is an Adolf Hitler book in the bookcase. It didn't matter who it was, I could still feel eventually feel a sort of sense of oneness
mm-hmm.
with that person. And at the end of the healing session, they were, it made me thank them, they were also literally relaxed. And I said, well, yeah, this is a two-way thing, and I feel on the heart. And I think it was because it was getting rid of the judgment and sort of feeling the one in person.
Right, thank you for that. That's it. So, the challenge with that is maintaining it, right? On a 24/7 basis. So you have the touching, but then there seems to be, so we get a lot of that, where we get glimpses of what it should be like that.
Mm-hmm.
But then there seems to be work to do about the plan, isn't it?
I think the trouble was, Ken, in the
yeah.
end, I don't think, the other part of my mind came, and I thought, well, are you doing it for the right reason? You know,
right.
But, you know, are you going to just kind of get a high or not? And then I'll be thinking about the next week, this person came back and said, well, how actually made any difference then? And then I would think, well, if I was in their position and I could sit down and talk to somebody without being judged, I could relax, do some nice music, well, wouldn't I feel better for that? But is that there has the problem actually gone? And so I've done this a number of times and then dropped out because I don't know that, you know, that I'm having any impact on it.
No, and you won't, in my opinion, because it's all about attention. What was the intention? The intention here is on God. That's the first slide I put up. The intention is on waking up. The intention is on God's plan for whatever that is. And so often we figure out, this is what we call metaphysical fixes or techniques that people learned back in the 80s is when it really took off. And they were great because they taught us we have so much more power than we thought. But the problem is the purpose behind them, the reason for wielding them, was never clear. And they don't have any. The only game in town is reestablishing our awarenesses, our oneness with God, period. Then that has to be the intention. And then these things are simply tools that are used by the Holy Spirit when and if He chooses to, versus ends in themselves. And see, back in the 80s, they became ends in themselves. Watch me heal someone. Watch me manifest money. Watch me do. You know, they became ego sports. Instead, they're like a toolbox that we put in the hands of the Holy Spirit and say, screw all that. I just want to know my oneness with God. I want to heal. And that's the difference here, is the reason for doing this change. And so because of the intention becomes the result. So what we encourage is just one God, that's it. Everything else is ego trying to distract us from that. And it can use all of this for this. It can use the Course in Miracles. I can decide I want to be famous. I can decide I want to write books. I can decide I want to make money. These are all traps. You know, be a course teacher. Screw it, I don't care about any of that. I'll never talk again, I'll never write again. That's not right. I only want God's plan for awakening. That's it. The ego can hijack all that very, very easily and say, wow, these people are coming to your seminars and you're making money. But why don't take any money for this? What I'm saying is that'll happen. So that's why I don't take any money, by the way. I'm an egoholic and I didn't want to be susceptible to doing any of this for any other reason than for glory to God, period. That's why that stuff doesn't, in its own, doesn't necessarily get you what your heart wants. Your heart wants to go. So if we don't set that intention, that's not what happens. We just get the intention. We have a set, which is the person who has a nice feeling. So the Holy Spirit uses everything. He could use making somebody a milkshake. You know, someone's feeling really down, and you make them a milkshake and show someone else actually care. And suddenly they have an opening to that milkshake. And here we are thinking it has to be all great for laying our hands on. Oh, no, it isn't all. But it's He's the one doing it. What did Jesus say when He healed the leper? And they said, great sir, do not call me great, this is God's word. I'm just the guy standing there. Something like that. Going to show up as this perfect being at the level of form. But I like it first. Even he didn't show up as this perfect, you know, maybe he was, but who would be saying?
Well,
I get the point.
He was coming in with an ego, don't do it. I want to produce an alcoholic sponsor. An AA sponsor would not be very
Well, I don't know. I think we need to be really careful. The stories are the stories. And they're there for our benefit. We don't know what happened. We don't know what he was going through. All we can know is what they mean for us. And we have the same stories for Buddha. We have the same stories for Krishna and all that kind of stuff. And we can say, what is it saying to me? And that's what matters. We don't know the story. You know, in Islam, what happened with the crucifixion, as I told you in the story. You know, who knows?
We don't know.
No, but you know what it means for you.
Yeah, no.
You know how Holy Spirit has used that children's story. It's what they are, as children's stories. Remember, be like little children, throw all your cares upon your Father. This is what Jesus said. Like little children, be children's stories. But they're useful for us, aren't they? Because they help us get out something. And I think if we try to get too historically accurate or say it was this or that, we're missing the point of it's trying to get to the essence of something that matters to us
yet
right now.
And nobody knows what the historical accuracy is. But I suppose what I'm saying is this is where Holy Spirit revealed Jesus.
For you.
Revealed him on the cross to me as giving up his ego and his dying breath. So my God, why have you forsaken me? It's the last outpouring of his ego.
Right.
And then into my hands, what to say? I
commend my spirit.
I commend my spirit. That was his.
That's what's in the Bible.
Yeah, that's how it's been revealed to me. That was for his ego.
Yeah, and that works for you. And that's fine. Who knows? And all these stories are used to help. But the trick is, read a Holy Spirit and say, how does this help? Because that's all that matters. That's the cash value. What does it mean for me now? Not a historian. Being a historian is no point. It has no cash value. What does this mean for me now? What is it trying to teach me? So when I read, be like little children and follow your cares upon your Father, I see a wonderful cross reference in the New Testament. I don't know if he ever really said that or not. You know what? The Holy Spirit speaks to me from that. I'm good with that. I like it. You know? So that's what I look at. I just spent too long in theology classes and those texts, and so I hacked out that. So you never know. That's a good thing too, because in order to get the meaning, I have to go to the Holy Spirit and say, which parts of this? You know, we have to read your spiritual text with the Holy Spirit. We can't rely on the words. So Jesus spoke Aramaic. The first text was written down 100 years after the crucifixion at Calvary. It was translated into Latin 300 years later, and in between it happened these Treaty of Nicaea and all kinds of hack jobs to the church. God knows what gets to us today in English, right? So on the other hand, you can read them and your heart says, God, there's some truth in that. And so really powerful too. It doesn't matter if words aren't quite right, that comes that would be worth. So good. Okay. Where are we at? Should we take a break? We'll come back and what we're gonna do when we come back is do daily practice, do a couple of meditations and sharing on the first one will be what is forgiveness. We'll compare notes when Holy Spirit shows us. That's always a fun one. Okay?